Good morning, choir. Nice to have you here. Thank you, Wanda. Good morning, everyone. I am delighted that you're here. God is delighted that you're here. The people sitting around you are glad that you're here. And we even have sunshine this morning. Yes. We have a bunch of announcements to share today. And Wanda, since you're there, the microphone is right down there somewhere. Grab the microphone and tell us some good news.
We are blessed with so much wonderful music in this church. We have a couple of concerts I want to tell you about. Tomorrow, Sunday afternoon, there is you see an insert in your program. This is a group that is not especially connected to this church, but it will be a lovely concert if you like this kind of music. It's a quartet, three violins and a cello, so that's a little bit different. But they were formed at the University of Washington, and that will be a really lovely program tomorrow evening, actually at 7:30. So you are all invited to come and hear this beautiful music. Then next Sabbath afternoon, March 4, the Trio Nova Mundi, the New World Trio, is coming. Many of you remember Becky Billick Aldrich, who did her doctoral studies here at the University of Washington, started at Walla Walla. And she lives currently in Pittsburgh and has formed this group, which has now traveled all over the world. And they will be blessing us with music entirely by women composers next Sabbath afternoon at 2 p.m. And so you are warmly welcome to that. We're working on putting together some food for those who would like to attend worship and then stay for that concert, so that it makes it easy for you to do that and not have to go out and deal with a restaurant and get back. And so do mark your calendars for that. This is going to be a really beautiful concert, a real treat. And then lastly this morning, we are going to share Curtis Lacey's final offering in his Seasons set of pieces. This one is called Winter. And we do want you to understand that it is not our fault if it snows tonight. We scheduled this long before they started talking about possible snow in the Seattle area tonight. But that's a heads up that they're talking about that. Curtis has blessed us with these wonderful pieces that he has created, both the words and the music for, in the style that he likes, which is a little bit sort of a jazz, vocal jazz style. So it's a little different than what you hear our choir usually sing. So we hope you enjoy that today.
Thank you, Wanda. Wow, lots of music. Thank you to all the musicians connected with this church. Now lift our hearts. Wow, fantastic. Tomorrow afternoon, 4 o'clock, is our monthly neighborhood meal. We partner with other churches in providing this meal, and tomorrow afternoon is our time to do it in the month of February. Information is there in your bulletin, the address of the place where we are providing the meal, and contact information for people if you would like to be part of that. So that's tomorrow afternoon. Also, another outreach opportunity, right below that in your bulletin. Lowell Dunston is putting together a group to help out at Northwest Harvest. And again, information there in your bulletin. I think he said right now there's 2 carloads of folks planning to go, I think on March 8th, but they could still take more if you would like to be part of this. In the lobby, right by the front door, there is a golden can. I won't call it a trash can. It's a golden can. And it is there to receive donations of clothing and other items like that from Mary's Place. So if you are wanting to, you have some treasures at your house that could be used better by others, this would be a wonderful way to do that. Finally, I will, oh, wait a minute, not finally. I've got... Oh, Greg, come on up here.
Hello?
Yep, hello. It'll be on.
Oh, all right. Hi, everybody. my name is Greg, and this is... Her name is Ava, and this is my oldest daughter. Believe it or not, she's only 4, so she's huge. Other than that, so as Pastor John was saying, There is a gold can right outside the front door. And that's actually for my daughter. Actually, we took a trip to Mary's Place in North Seattle, and things that she saw, I feel like kids shouldn't have to go through that. So what separates one family from another is just a piece of string and blankets hung up. And she decided that she wanted to sit there and make donations for Mary's Place. So I don't know if it says in the bulletin, but I'll probably have a piece of paper outside, a couple bulletins outside, letting you guys know what people need, especially in, you know, situations like that. So from kids' clothes to also adults and sizes, all, and also hygiene products. But other than that, I just want to have her get the decision to, you know, give instead of always receiving, to especially giving to people less fortunate than we are. So thank you guys, and want to say anything? I guess not. Thank you guys.
Thank you, Greg. So we now have two faces on this project. If Greg is intimidating, you can talk to Ava. Sounds like if you need instructions, you might want to talk to Greg. But inspiration, just look at Ava and you'll be inspired. Wonderful. And Mika, you have something to tell us about. Yeah. Pastor Mika has been leading our Wednesday Bible study.
Good morning, everyone. Just a quick note on Wednesday mornings, for a while now, 10:30, upstairs in the library, there's a Bible study. Currently, we're going through the book of John, and it's always a lot of conversation and some Bible study, too. So we have a good time, and we're sharing a lot. It's lovely to be with each other. Thank you. Oh, you're all invited.
You know, they don't have to make a reservation?
No reservation.
No reservation. All right. 10:30 on Wednesday, right here. Okay. Thank you, Pastor Mika. The last announcement is down at the bottom of the announcement page here on your bulletin. March 11, we have the lecture series coming up. Well, March 10 and 11, Friday night and Sabbath. So that is, what, that 2 weekends from now? Am I doing my math right? The focus for the weekend will be the film work of Deneen Akers and Stephen Eyre. Several years ago, they produced a documentary called Seventh Gay Adventist. This film has been shown on most Adventist campuses here in the U.S. and around the world. It's been shown in a lot of places. I've seen it. It's a fascinating story of three couples and their involvement with the Adventist Church. We will show that on Friday night, and then Sabbath afternoon, another film called A Place at the Table, which captures highlights of a weekend where Stephen and Deneen brought together 12 people with wildly different views about how the church should respond to the questions surrounding homosexuality, and it's this dialogue, debate, conversation, whatever word you want to use, as they're processing. They do not agree, and they don't come to agreement, but the film attempts to picture how Christians can process these kinds of differences and still be in community. And then, of course, Sabbath morning for Sabbath school, we'll have Deneen and Stephen doing the Sabbath school program. It should be a fascinating weekend. I hope you can join us. Might want to invite your friends. So that'll be Friday night and Sabbath, March 10 and 11. More details there in your bulletin. Now, I'm going to invite you to stand and greet one another here in God's house, past God's peace. And while you're doing that, I'm going to greet the folks watching over live stream. So if you are watching over the live stream, we welcome you. We're delighted that you're with us via the electronic medium. One thing I'd like to encourage you to do, if you would, is find us on Facebook and check in. Let us know that you're there, that you're watching. And if you check in on Facebook, others who are watching at different places can also see, and we can create a bit of a sense of community electronically, in addition to the real community that we have here in this building. So thanks. Thanks for being with us, and hope you get a blessing from the service. Let's open our hearts as the choir invites us into worship.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Almighty God, thank you for the glory of your light this morning. Thank you for the blessing of your smile. Lord of the cosmos, we pray that you will order all things, far and nigh, according to your sweet will. Create peace. Lord of our hearts, we pray that you will work in us and through us to accomplish the goals of your kingdom. Help us to be your agents to bring help and hope and healing. Is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
About 10 days ago, we were at my oldest son's place on Bainbridge Island to celebrate a Valentine's dinner with my two grandchildren who are 9 and 7. And Darwin always wants to sit by Grandpa. He's a very active 7-year-old boy. And as we sat down at the table, he says, "Grandpa, do you need any money? Daddy just got a work bonus, and if you and Grandma need some money, we could sure give you some." And I thought of the words of our Lord, who often used children to illustrate the principles of the kingdom. So this morning as we give, let us give in the spirit of a child. As it says in the bulletin, that the offering today is for conference ministries, and that includes education, Sunset Lake Camp, and evangelism. So let us give with a cheerful heart, like a child, as the deacons wait on you today, to have the deacons stand for prayer. God, we thank you for our children. We thank you for the many blessings that you've poured out on us. And today we would pray that you will multiply our gifts to serve your world. Thank you. Amen.
Thank you. kitties that lived with me. One was named Pumpkin, and the other was named Elijah. And I learned so much living with kitties. They were each very different, and Elijah, as you can see, was black. Pumpkin is my yellow kitty, you see. And I had special routines with each of them. And they both love to go camping. Have you guys ever seen a cat that liked to go camping?
No.
That's really different for a cat to like that. But they like to go, and I love them, and I miss them every day. But I'm very grateful that I had the privilege of living with these cats. They brought a lot of diversity to my life. Do you know what diversity is? Sometimes it brings things that you weren't expecting. And sometimes not even things that you wanted, but I learned a lot from them. So today I'm going to tell you a story about a mother who brought a new kitty to her home, and her home was a farm. Now, this farm was so far from a city, it didn't even have electricity, and we need electricity to have loud sound and to turn on the lights, and they didn't have that on her farm, and her children weren't able to watch TV. And without TV, they had to go outside and actually play, but they enjoyed that, to find adventure. Their farm had chickens and ducks and sheep, and they had some bunnies, goat, and cows. Kind of sounds like the McLarty household, doesn't it?
Maybe some horses.
Maybe, but they had cats. Now, the thing about a farm, when it's a working farm, everybody has a job. And the cats had a very important job on the farm. Their job was to keep the varmints under control. Now, it's okay to have a rat or a couple of gophers, but if they start eating others' food, it doesn't work out very well on a farm. So cats really aren't like pets that we're used to. They're supposed to be working. Well, when this mother put the kitten in the back seat with her children, she heard coming from the back seat as the children took turns holding that gray kitten whose name was Smokey. Her husband remarked that it was the loudest purr he'd ever heard from such a little kitten. Well, the mom was worried that that cat might not understand its role on the farm, and that was varmint control. And so when she found Smokey sleeping on the bed with her son, she picked up the cat and gently tossed him off the bed, and plop, that cat fell right on the floor. Now, she'd never met a cat that didn't land on all fours. All cats are known for landing on 4 feet, not on their side. That cat was different. The next morning, when she picked Smokey up, he didn't hold a grudge. When she put him up next to her neck, he purred in a really nice purr. And he was a great companion to everybody. He had chores to do on the farm. He helped keep company in the garden. And when they were picking lettuce, he munched on it. And when they were getting to the green beans and some of the other vegetables, he tasted them, make sure they were ripe. And while the other working cats, whose job it was to keep the varmints under control, would come and put a little bit of leftover varmint in his bowl, he'd go, "Oh no, what's that?" Well, most cats know that it's a really nice gift if you get given part of a mouse, but he didn't know that. He was a really different cat. Well, Smokey continued to live with the family and provide extra heat and comfort to the laps in the winter and company whenever somebody needed a little company. But one cold November morning, right before Thanksgiving, one of the older children was sick, and she was upstairs. Now, mothers know when you're not being quiet in your room. When you're supposed to be taking a nap, they know when you're not taking a nap. But the mom thought, well, they're resting, and she'll get better. And all of a sudden, she heard, "Mom, fire!" If you live in a house that doesn't have running water, and doesn't have electricity, and your pipes are all frozen for your water tank, fire is very bad thing. She ran up the stairs. She took a bucket of water with her, and she gave the littlest child to her older daughter and said, "Now you need to go outside where it's safe." And she threw the water on the fire, but the fire kept going. So then she grabbed a quilt, and sometimes you can get rid of a fire with a quilt, but it started burning. And then she got another quilt and two more quilts, and they kept burning. So she'd go, and when she looked behind her, her daughter was watching her. She hadn't left the house. She was just struck. So she herded the children all outside, and then she went back in, and she thought, well, let's see, what do I get? I need to get pictures, and I have a painting, and I have a piano. And then right out of the corner of her eye, a little gray cat came running by, and he was looking for a way out. It was Smokey. So she picked up Smokey, and she picked up her guitar and her purse, and she went outside, and the cat ran away. Everybody was safe, but she needed to get back inside, and her daughter said, "Mom, look!" And the glass was melting on the house. The house was being destroyed, and right where she would have gone back into the house and been standing, trying to pick out what was special to her, she would have been trapped by the fire as the fire took over the house. Well, when she looked at the thought of this cat, Smokey, most people would have looked at Smokey and said, "Smokey has no value on this farm. He doesn't provide the varmint control he was brought here for." But because of him, no lives were lost. And there's a text in the Bible that says, God chose the weak things of the world to shame the wise. And she believes that God used a vegetable-loving cat who couldn't land in his feet in a big way that day, and that real treasures are not bound to our things, but that own the people and the animals that we love. Thank you. Let's collect some of money for a Holbrook school now. Grab your buckets.
Thank you.
Dear Lord, our Creator God, our Redeemer, and our soon coming King, this morning we have much to be grateful for. We're amazed at how you can love us individually and unconditionally, every person in this world. We're grateful for the health and the strength and the energy to work that you've bestowed on each one of us. And we're especially grateful for our families and our friends and our church fellowship here at Green Lake. We're glad for the freedom that we and liberty that we have in our country. This morning we come presenting various needs in our congregation. First, we have names listed in our bulletin who are ill and who need your special attention. We would also pray this morning for those who have recently lost loved ones, that your sustaining arms can surround them and bring comfort. We present the many diverse needs of our hurting world. And this morning we ask for you to look down on each of our family members and the many extended members of this church family who may be scattered all around the world. May they each have a special Sabbath day's blessing and experience your peace and your care. As we kneel today, we ask for the forgiveness of sin. And we pray that as we participate in music, scripture, and the spoken word, that we can enter another week empowered to serve effectively and to make a positive difference in our world. We look forward to the day when Jesus can come again and right all wrongs. And may that day be soon. We pray in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Testament reading is cited from Joshua 5, verses 10 through 15. While the Israelites were camped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, they celebrated Passover on the evening of the 14th day of the first month. The very next day, they began to eat unleavened bread and roasted grain harvested from the land. No manna appeared on the day they first ate from the crops of the land, and it was never seen again. So from that time on, the Israelites ate from the crops of Canaan. When Joshua was near the town of Jericho, he looked up and saw a man standing in front of him with a sword in hand. Joshua went up to him and demanded, "Are you friend or foe?" At this, neither one, he replied, "I am the commander of the Lord's army." And at this, Joshua fell with his face to the ground in reverence. "I am at your command," Joshua said. "What do you want your servant to do?" The commander of the Lord's army replied, "Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy." Joshua did as he was told.
Thank you. The New Testament readings are selected from Acts chapter 7, 8, and 9. As they stoned him, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." He fell to his knees, shouting, "Lord, don't charge them with this sin." And with that, he died. Saul was one of the witnesses, and he agreed completely with the killing of Stephen. A great wave of persecution began that day, sweeping over the church in Jerusalem, and all the believers except the apostles were scattered through the regions of Judea and Samaria. Some devout men came and buried Stephen with great mourning. But Saul was going everywhere to destroy the church. He went from house to house, dragging out both men and women to throw them into prison. Meanwhile, Saul was uttering threats with every breath and was eager to kill the Lord's followers. So he went to the high priest. He requested letters addressed to the synagogues in Damascus, asking for their cooperation in the arrest of any followers of the way that he found there. He wanted to bring them both, men and women, back to Jerusalem in chains. As he was approaching Damascus on this mission, a light from heaven suddenly shone down around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked, and the voice replied, "I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of the word."
Thanks be to God.
There is a movie that's fairly famous. And in the movie, a young man announces, sword in hand, "Hi, my name is Inigo Montoya. Prepare to die." To be honest, I don't even remember the scene. I just remember the words. And all week, as I was working on my sermon, I kept, you know, hearing this guy. In fact, when I told the story at the school, I put it in the wrong movie, and the kids kept staring at me until finally I go, no, it's Princess Bride. Oh, all right. But I kept hearing in my head these words, and I imagined the sword. You know, wow, got my sword. Prepare to die. I hope that's not a sacrilegious picture, but as I read the text for my sermon today, I just could not avoid hearing this in my head. Joshua was God's man, no question about it. Moses had been leading the people of Israel for 40 years. An incredible human being. Moses has died. Can you imagine trying to fill Moses' shoes? That would be a pretty tall order. But now Joshua is the guy. He is the leader. Moses had appointed Joshua as his successor. Then after Moses died, God appeared to Joshua several times, and the account is in the first part of the book of Joshua. God appeared to him and saying, "Look, I'm with you. I was with Moses. I will be with you. You know, with Moses, I brought my people out of Egypt. With you, I will bring my people into Canaan." Moses was God's man. I'm sorry, Joshua, Moses was too. Joshua was God's man. No question. At one point, Israel is getting ready to cross the Jordan River. This is big drama. They have, all the 40 years they've been dreaming of crossing the river into Canaan. It's going to happen today. God comes to Joshua that morning going, Joshua, look, today I'm going to begin magnifying you or exalting you in the eyes of your people. Yeah, he did. So this horde of people, these vast crowd, moves toward the Jordan River. At the front of the crowd are the priests of God carrying the Ark of the Covenant. These priests, they come down to the river, and the river is in spring flood, and as their feet touch the water stops flowing from upstream. Somehow upstream, the water is blocked, and then it begins falling away downstream. And eventually there is this path across the river. And the crowd goes across the river, get on the other side, they set up camp. And I love it. So at the beginning, God says, I'm going to begin honoring you among the people. Over there he says, today I have honored you among the people. Brackets this great event. Yes. Joshua is God's man. He is leading God's people. They are going into the promised land. It doesn't get any better than that. I don't know how you can be more affirmed than that. It's important to have that as a background for the prepare to die scene. Joshua, after people have gotten all set up camp, Joshua goes for a walk. I'm guessing he goes for a walk along the river. Does he come around a big oak tree? Does he come around a big rock? Make the movie in your head the way you need to. In my head, it's got to be an oak tree. A great big oak tree there in the floodplain of the Jordan. The path comes up and goes around the tree, and Joshua comes up, and as he goes around the tree, and there's thickets and all of that, right in front of him, there's this guy standing there with a sword drawn. And it's a fairly impressive dude. The Bible doesn't tell it, but I cannot help imagining that when Joshua comes around and he sees this guy, Joshua whips his sword out. Now, maybe he didn't, but that's not a very good movie. He had to have whipped his sword out. He whips his sword out and he says, okay, you, are you on our side or are you on the enemy side? Who are you for, us or the enemy? It's a reasonable question. Joshua is part of an invading army. He knows because his spies have told him the people in Canaan are terrified. And they are also warriors. Here's a warrior, so you ask the question, whose side are you on? Are you an enemy? Are you with us? And what does the stranger say? Neither. And play with that for just a minute. For Joshua, this is almost a crazy-making answer. You can't be neither. You're either with us, and we're coming in to take the place, or you're with them, they're trying to stop us. Neither. And then the stranger says, I am the commander of the armies of God. And apparently something about him is persuasive enough that Joshua believes those words. And then what does Joshua do? He drops his sword. He falls on his face. And he says, so what do you want me to do? What are your orders? And I love that change of posture. You first see Joshua, he's a warrior. He's ready to go. He gives challenges. Who are you? What are you doing? I'll take you down. And then he goes down. When we encounter God, we go down in a good sense. We drop our blustering. We drop our swaggering. We drop our self-assertion. We become receptive. We're ready to hear what God has to say, even if God appears to be a human. It seems to me that it's natural for us as humans, if we imagine ourselves to be strong people, when you encounter another strong person, you kind of take their measure. Some of you may have had a hot car when you were younger, and you pull up to a stoplight, and somebody else pulls up beside you, and the question, okay, you're on. Right? I think a few of you smiling like maybe you did that once. I have to laugh. At our house, we have, in our pasture, we have our daughter's cows. These cows have great big horns, they're about this long. And it's very interesting that the whole point of these horns, apparently, is to establish dominance. The big guy, they're all cows, no bulls. The cow with the biggest horns is supposed to be the boss. Right now there's another cow that wants to be boss pretty bad. But as long as the old gal is there, she's in charge. And my daughter says we can never separate them, because if we ever separate them and they come back together, there will be war, because they're going to have to decide, you know, who's boss. You know, they're going to wave those horns around. Think about Joshua with his sword. That guy has a sword. I got my sword. It's natural, that contest of power. And when the contest is serious, it's natural for us as humans to divide the world in two. Us and the enemy. And I want to know where you stand. Are you with us? Are you with the enemy? And then it's fairly easy to go the next step and to sort of ask the question, so which side is God on? If I knew sports better, I'd use a sports analogy. But I'd mess it up. Is God on your team side? You know, come Super Bowl time, do you pray? Oh God, hope you're on our side. And we laugh about that. But it is a symptom of something that's much deeper rooted in humanity. When there's conflict, we imagine that there's us and the enemy, and surely God is on our side. Except he's not. You know, this passage captures one of the deepest truths of our religion. If you go back to Palestine, go back to the days of Israel, every tribe had its God. One of the differences between the God of the Hebrews as they developed their spiritual life over time is they more and more understood that their God was not merely their tribal God. Their God was the God of all. And that meant that the prophet was just as likely to wag his finger under the nose of the king of Israel as he was to talk about the evils of Babylon. In fact, if you go through the Bible, there is far more rebuke given to the leaders of Israel than there is given to the leaders of the bad guys, Philistines, the Babylonians, the Egyptians. Because God was not a tribal God. He was not on somebody's side. He stood above those sides. It's a deep truth. And we need to learn it in church. I was laughing. Last night, I was driving home. It was way too late. On a Friday night, I've got to preach the next day. I should be in bed early, right? No, it was late. We're driving home. And we get to a stoplight, I confess, and I pulled out my phone to see what this latest thing was that beeped on my phone. And then when I got home, I read it again. Somebody had sent me a message that had been posted by an Adventist minister. And the point of the message was, if you're not with us, you're not with God. And the person going, does that sound right? And I read it, and I went back, and I go, well, it sounds a little funny to me, given my sermon this week. But it is very easy for us as Adventists to imagine that God's on our side, and he's against all those people out there. In fact, that has been part of our public theology for a long time. But we need to be careful because it's simply false. We do not own God. You know? God is not on our side. Unless, it is interesting, if you go through the Bible and you ask, whose side is God on? There is actually a side that God is on according to the prophets. The problem is that once you identify the side that God's on, it takes a lot of guts to join that side voluntarily. In fact, if you're a parent or a grandparent, you don't want your kids or grandkids on that side. In the Bible, whose side is God on? When God says, look, I'm picking a side. I'm for these people and I'm against those people. Who is he for? Foreigners. 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 100 times in the prophets. Widows. Orphans. Poor people. Women who don't have children and want them. I'm going to, forgive me for using this next word. If you want to know whose side God is on, he's on the side of the losers. If you see yourself as a loser, God's on your side. Take comfort. But most of us would rather not see ourselves that way. And in fact, for most of us, if we try to picture ourselves that way, we're not seeing clearly. Most of us are winners. Most of us have a credit card that if our tire got shredded, you just pull out the credit card and magically you got a new tire on your car. We don't need God, we got Visa. Most of us, when we read about tightening down on people being kicked out of the country, we can just turn over and go back to sleep. Most of us are not losers. We're winners. Which means God is not on our side. We can choose to be on God's side, but we cannot choose to have him on our side. If you imagine a softball recess at school, picking teams, you can't pick God to be on your team. As I mentioned last week, but it just jumps out of these encounters with God. If we read encounters with God in Scripture, one thing jumps out over and over again. You don't walk away from there bragging about having God in your pocket. As nationalism sweeps across the Northern Hemisphere, we have the president of the East, Russia, and the president of the U.S., both attempting to link nationalism, a radical commitment to the notion that my nation is the best, the top. If we link that idea with Christianity, we don't know Christ. Christianity does not support anybody's nationalism. From day one, from the days of Jesus, Christianity has always been supranational. Always. And we need to keep that alive as a people of God. And then we need to pray that God will give us the wisdom and the courage to join his side. It would be easier to just let God take care of the losers and stay over here. You know, God, you go take care of that. Those people are hungry. God, you better feed them. Those people need a little healing. God, you're really good at it. Go for it. Those people are unpopular. God, can you go love them? Wouldn't it be nice if we could just sort of send God over to take care of stuff? And he's better at it than we are. The problem is that he's given that job to us. Whose side are we on? God gives it to us. Will we join God in his mission, or will we attempt to lasso God and make him ours? The choice is clear. Let's stand with God. Let's pray. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.